an older of any teacher within the AI Institute in Toulouse. So Nicolas did his PhD at INRIA Rennes with François Chomet on visual surveying for robotics. And now his main text is on locomotion for complex systems like legged robots. And so today the talk of Nicolas is about artificial locomotion and should we learn or optimize locomotion for legged robots. So the floor is you, Nicolas, and thank you very much for accepting to be the presenter of today.
Oh, it's a pleasure. So it's an online session, and obviously they are less interactive. So I would try to bank some breaks in the middle to seek for questions. But yes, please don't hesitate to interact. I'm very pleased and honored to be here, even if virtually. Would like very much if it is possible to produce interaction. So currently in robotics, let's maybe directly go with the content. I'm doing robotics. Robotics is one of the challenges of AI and one of the open challenge, one for which we are seeking a lot of expectation as well. And among robotics, there is many motion that we can look at. I'm particularly interested by locomotion, and to me, it's an evidence. When I ask my kids to draw some robots, they would draw robots with legs. And when there is no legs, it's even worse than the next, like a single wheel or even a flying robot. That's not one of the drawing of my kid, but the other one are. Like, this one would be a nightmare to control. This, for me, is maybe coming from an old documentary that I saw when I was a teenager on the BBC, on Arte, BBC documentary. Showing two group of research, one by the lab from Marc Rebert in MIT, where in the 90s they were making some robots jump and walk and run. And for that, they were using what we call now model-based approaches. So they were trying to understand as much as possible the behavior of the robots, trying to build it at the same time, and really using a lot of intuition. To build these robots and to make them work. The second part of the documentary was about this result by Carl Sims on the IBM cluster. So at that time, IBM had built a giant cluster, and they were seeking for opportunity of using it. So they were basically trying to sell CPU time that nobody wanted to use. And for that, they hired Carl Sims, somebody that was coming from graphical animation, to do some fancy motion generation in simulation. And for that, what Carl Sims did is that he first built a simulator, and then he produced an evolution algorithm, so a gradient-free algorithm, to at the same time optimize the morphology of the creatures and their movement, first in a simulated water, and then on a floor. So that would give rise to database approaches or model, what we call model free. Well, actually, we can discuss that because actually, in the work of Marc Rebert, there is no model, or in the beginning, very little model, but a lot of intuition. While the first stuff that Carl Sims built to collect data was a simulator, so a model. So these namings are to be discussed a lot, but we still see this trend of model-based approaches, typically used by Boston Dynamics on the spot robot, and database approaches that we typically see by the ETH Zurich, the team of Marco Uter, with the animal robot being trained by reinforcement and able to go in any terrain. And well, we, at that point, we really have two very, very different methods, very competitive, and we can discuss the pros and cons. In terms of the user point of view, maybe we would say that Spot is a little bit more able to go on a structured terrain where it can show more efficiency. So he's able to exploit this structure. While Animal is a little bit more all terrain, so he's able to go in the mountain, and he has been demonstrated walking, hiking a mountain around Zurich. So that discrepancy between these two corpus of method is really what I want to discuss today and what I'm interested by a lot in my work. But maybe before going into an explanation of how these methods work and why they are different, we can first spend a little bit of time to understand what is the difficulty in this particular work of locomotion. So why is leg robotics particularly interesting, at least for me? So the first point is that locomotion is a good benchmark. I'm very interested by methods that would make the robot walk in the sense that when they would be able to walk, they would be able to do other stuff as well. And in particular, locomotion is known to be a dual of manipulation. And you see with this schematic that the way you are manipulating an object by exerting forces on it would be the same as having an object manipulating itself by pushing on a world to create forces to locomote. So both problems actually are quite much the same. They are written in the same mathematics, the same models. When so a lot of theoretical aspects and practical aspects are the same. In locomotion in particular, you see this aspect of first delayed reward. That we also call viability in locomotion, the fact that you don't immediately see that your locomotion is stable. You see that a little while ago, like five seconds afterward. So you do a wrong decision now, and 5 seconds later, you would be on the ground. And the penalization, you typically get it when you hit the ground. But at that point, it's way too late to change your past decision. A second aspect that is very important in locomotion is constraints. Our robot is full of constraints. And the first constraint is under actuation, the fact that you cannot control all your movements. The placement of your body in space is decided by the forces that you will apply to the environment. And that's limited by a lot of constraints, friction cones for the forces that you apply, torque limits, joint limits, so impact that you can sustain, the temperature of your motors. All that are hard constraints. They are constraints coming from the physics, and you cannot bargain with them. If you bargain, you will burn your robot. And the last point that is, I think, very interesting in locomotion is the need of controlling your forces. You are not so much interested by your movements, but rather by the forces that you apply in the environment that would trigger that would trigger your movement. And this aspect of being driven by force lead to additional instability that in lab we can release by controlling the motion of the robot by doing a position control, something that is very stiff, that is working very well in factories, but I really think that when you go in the real world, it's not something that you can handle anymore. In general, all these three challenges, you would find it in many other domains. And for me, these are three examples of humanoid robots. They're not humanoids anymore, but they are containing exactly the same challenges. First is the versatile manufacturing cell. Maybe this is the most important challenge in robotics today. That's where we would be very, very useful. Not in hospital or in kid gardens or for butler robots. That I think is totally useless and it's out of scope for now. But in factory, that would be super useful. Flying hands, so it's not exactly a humanoid robot, but now we need to have some manipulation by flying engines. And for now, this manipulation is done by humans. So here, that's two operators at EDF that need to connect to a high tension line. And I guess that, well, they feel something when they are here. And mobile manipulators, so maybe that's part of versatile manufacturing, but you want to bring a manipulation capability outside of the fixed scope of a manipulator, of a fixed manipulator. So either for logistics or for going outdoors, this is a terrain. And that robot also is subject to balance constraints. If you don't pay attention to what you are doing, then the robot will tilt over and break. Okay, so all the constraints that I'm going to show and exemplify and develop with a biped robot, which is my specialty, are really constraints that you would see in many, many other robots and are very topical challenges. So that's my vision of humanoid robotics, and that's why I'm very enthusiastic with humanoid robotics. Not so much for the humanoid robot itself, but for the versatile robotic worker, for the exoskeleton, for paraplegic people, for the flying hands, and for any kind of manipulation in factories. So after positioning a little bit why I'm doing all that, let's go now in really the detail of what is locomotion, how we take decision about the walk, and what is the artificial intelligence problem or the numerical problem that we can write to describe what locomotion is. So locomotion first is the decision on your body, and we have to keep in mind that we are not only doing software. When we are doing robotics, we are also doing hardware, and the first decision in the hardware is how many legs should I put to my robot. And for example, if you are on flat floor, well, the answer is zero. Put wheels on flat floor. Wheels are the best. No question about that. If you have enough space with respect to the size of your robot, then quadrupeds is the best. Quadrupeds, they are very versatile, very efficient, and they are stable, intrinsically stable. So it's difficult to make a quadruped walk, fall when he is on his full 4 feet. If you have an increased safety issue, for example, in a nuclear plant, or here for this tree cutter robot, then maybe six is better, but six legs would be more cumbersome. So the robot would be slower just because the legs are going to collide each other. Biped robots start to be interesting when you have constrained range. So if you want to enter in a human human defined room, then very likely you don't have enough space on the ground for a quadruped robot. And then a biped robot will start to be useful. So for example, when we are discussing with Airbus, they don't see a quadruped robot to be the future for them. They need something that is taking less space. Mixed solutions are of course very relevant. So here you have a centaur robot with four legs, two arms and a torso, and the legs, they are equipped with wheels. And then on flat floor, he would be able to roll, and then he can also walk. Wheels are, at the end of the feet are very good as well, but they are heavier. Then that would make your robot less efficient in terms of walking. But if the robot is rolling 90% of the time, it's good. And then you have also fancy stuff like this shaft robot, which has two knees per leg, so four knees in total, and two elbows per arm, so four elbows in total. On this one, that's the inheritance of this one, he has no knees, he has linear actuators. So the legs would stretch with the rail. Okay, so that's the first point in locomotion. Hardware is super, super important. The second point is to model your robot. Historically, the first model that had been proposed for locomotion were simplified models. We had, at that time, first, we were not able to make a computationable model of the full body. And also, we were seeking for analytical solutions, so solutions we were able to understand. So that were the first studies. And many different models have been proposed. You can see, for example, here the yo-yo man, that was the favorite model of Jean-Paul Lomont. The one that is maybe the most useful now are for quadrupeds, the flying potatoes, or at least that's the name that was given by for this model in MIT. The one that I think is the most interesting for biped locomotion is the so-called table cart model. So in a table cart model, we are going to only consider the mass of a concentrating point, and this point can evolve both horizontally and vertically. On the vertical direction, the dynamics is super, super simple. We have a mass, then there is gravity, so there is a weight force towards the ground. And this weight force, you are going to compensate with the force, a vertical force. And wherever the cart is on the horizontal plane, this weight force is going to be exactly the same. That's constant. Okay, so this dynamics is super interesting, scientifically speaking. And also, if you make mistakes in your model here, the resulting dynamics is going to be quadratic. So okay, it's going to fall, but quadratically, so not so fast. The second dynamics is horizontal. On the horizontal plane, we see the acceleration of the system, and this acceleration is going to be decided by where you are putting your force on the ground. And this point, we call it the center of pressure. Center of pressure, maybe you already saw it if you went to the doctor for the designing foot prosthesis. That this point, well, center of pressure would be the barycentrum of this pixel grid. The center of pressure is going to act on the acceleration of the center of mass, but depending on the distance between the center of pressure and the center of mass. So this dynamics is still linear, so it's still quite easy to solve. And we see now that if we are doing mistakes, the resulting behavior is going to be exponential. So if we fall forward, because for example, we don't apply the right center of pressure, then we would fall exponentially. So that's a little bit surprising. It means that we don't fall vertically, we fall horizontally. And that's behavior that you can see in babies. So this baby is smart, he falls horizontally, so towards the ground with a quadratic behavior, so it's easy to catch. While this baby, and that's mine, is not smart, he falls horizontally, so exponentially, and that's, well, more dramatic, or at least it's more pictural. He's safe. We just going to show that he's still alive. So this is really what the physics is saying. It's not a model, right? It's really when we take all the physics of the bodies, either the robot bodies or the human bodies, it's just telling us that we are going to move forward exponentially, and that's very difficult to control, while we are going to move downward only quadratically, and that's super easy to control. Of course, at some point, when we fall forward exponentially, our legs would be fully stretched, and then we would be brought to the ground. But the effect that is going to bring us to the ground is moving forward. Okay, so this model is nice. It's nice because it's very simple, and both from the computational point of view, it's linear, few number of variables, but also in terms of understanding what it means, it's telling us a lot of what we should do. And then we can now start to seek for what the robot should do with this model. So this is typically a view of what the robot should take as a decision. So the line here is the center of mass location around the time, and the squares are the foot location. So the robot should go right foot, left foot, etc. So that the center of mass is pushed toward one foot, then toward the other, toward one push, toward the other. And if the robot is at some point is pushed, then it should change its behavior. So here it would shift the foot on the left. So that is able to catch the center of mass that is exponentially leaving its support plane. And now it is cached, can go back pushing it to the reference trajectory. And the controller now must be able to decide both which force to apply. So in the case of this model, which center of pressure should it apply? And also where to put the foot next. That's the two decisions. And this where to put the foot next, when it is on the flat floor, it's only a continuous decision of where to put the foot. But actually, either when you have more number of feet, or you have a stair in front of you, it is going to be a discrete decision of which foot is going on which stair or step. Okay, so we say that this problem is hybrid in the sense that it's containing both continuous variables and discrete variables. To control this model, maybe the most intuitive solution is to say we are going to predict what the system is doing and control this prediction. And that's very important. This idea of prediction is super important because, as I said, we have a delayed reward. So we only see that we are falling a little bit ahead in time. So we need to predict this little bit ahead in time so that we are able to measure it, measure the prediction and correct it. So the so-called model predictive control concept is very easy to understand. You take a simulator that is able to predict properly what you are doing. You try a control sequence in this simulator. So for example, here on the rabbit, he has a simulator of the road, and he's going to try a sequence of going forward. And then he can see that at the end of this prediction, he's leaving the road, he's violating a constraint, and that's not good. Then he would try something else, a gradient descent, and you select going on the left, and he's again leaving the road. So the third try, he would see this yellow curve. It's not violating any constraint, but it's not the fastest one. And then finally, we'll get the fastest optimal trajectory, not violating the constraint. Okay, so the rabbit here is taking the decision about his future trajectory, optimizing an objective function, for example, minimizing energy or minimizing time, satisfying the constraints, the first constraint being where he is in the world, the second constraint being how the world is evolving, and many other constraints like don't keep the road. This decision problem is going to be written under a static optimization problem, non-linear cost, non-linear constraints, and we are going to search for the solution of that. Again, the solution of this problem is a trajectory, both in state space and in control space, and you can see that as here, but we are not going to follow this full trajectory. We are going just to apply the beginning of the control sequence, and as soon as possible, as soon as we have new sensor values and new computational times, we are going to recompute a new trajectory, in particular because following the trajectory or applying the control sequence is going to not be perfectly applied by the robot because the model that we have is never perfect. So we have to close the loop by taking a new decision. That's how, for example, this robot is working. So here we have a so-called flying potato model, considering the center of mass, but also the angular momentum of the robot, considering the forces that is applied on the environment and the location of the forces. Is taking on the fly the decision of where to put the foot and how to exert forces to move the center of mass. This is a predictive control scheme, taking a hybrid decision in real time. And that's able to go on a surface like that or climbing stairs. And so for this experiment, the robot is limited to 30 seconds. At the end of 30 seconds, it dies. That's it's not a bug, it's a feature. And yeah, you can see that it's able to climb the stairs. So I would say that this is the state of the art of leg locomotion. That's how leg robot now work, typically with one clever simplified model, predictive control, and then a little bit of arithmetic to pass from the simplified model to control of the whole body. The stake now in research is to move from this capability of control simplified well-designed model to capability of controlling the full model of the robot, not doing an intermediate smart decision by limiting the model, but saying that you just give a real model of what the robot is, and then a predictive control solver or something like that is going to take the decision of how the robot should work. So at that point of the speech, maybe I can take a break. I would now enter a little bit more in detail of what we are doing to go toward these objectives. Is anybody wanting to react to what I said? Yeah, so let's continue. So this is an example of taking the decision about the whole body of the robot. So in that case, we are asking to do a pick and place task. And we are taking the decision by simulating the entire robot body over 1 second of preview. And in simulation, when we look at what the robot was doing, we saw that it was going on the front part. And now going on the real robot, the student pushed it a little bit more than what we initially planned, and suddenly the robot starting to go backward, and that was a surprise. Okay, it's not a big surprise, it's a simple task, but that's exactly what we would expect from this predictability capabilities, that the robot is able to generalize on the flight, taking decision to something that was not expected before. So to do that, should we do optimization or learning? And I'm going to explain a little bit more what I mean by that. So I try to argue that one of the most convenient way of describing the behavior of a robot is by optimal control. So we define the behavior that we want to see on the robot by an objective function, either a cost function that you minimize or a reward function that you maximize. I tend to write stuff with cost function and minimum, but whatever, it's exactly the same. Subject to constraints, and the two main important constraints are the simulator, how you know that your state is going to evolve when you apply a control. So that's exactly literally what you have in a simulator. And your state estimator that is going to tell you where the robot is, what is the state of the robot at the beginning when the decision needs to be taken. The solution to this optimization problem is this complex geometry that you can understand as being two-shaped geometry. On one side, you can say that the solution to this problem is a trajectory. So a trajectory is a mathematical object that is going from time to control space. And if you are seeking for the solution to this optimization problem as a trajectory, then very likely you are doing some motion planning. Or you are inside a community that is calling itself motion planning. A second solution to this problem is this vector field that is telling you at each state point what is the control that you need to apply. So then the mathematical object that you try to optimize is what we call a policy. So policy is a function from state space to control space, telling you at each state what you should do. And if you are seeking for the solution of this problem under this form, it's likely that you are doing reinforcement learning. And actually, both mathematical objects are an acceptable answer to this problem. We can say several stuff on that. First, that maybe it's a little bit stupid that we consider both separately. Ouais. Second point is that likely the motion planning problem is going to be easier to solve because this is a function from time, which is dimension one, to control, while this is a function from state, dimension typically with my robot, dimension 100, to the control space. So this object is likely bigger than this one, for some definition of bigger. And that's sane because this trajectory optimization problem, we are going to need to solve it in real time. So online on the robot would need to iterate and repeatedly solve this problem. For each new state, you would get a new trajectory. While this one, if you are able to optimize the policy, then you can do that offline once forever. When you build your robot, you optimize the policy and then it's done. You don't have to modify it anymore. Experience of optimization is that very often when there is two variables that are solution of an optimization problem, good algorithms are using both to solve the solution. So I would guess it is the same here, but on my side, I'm in the motion planning community, so I'm seeking for the solution as a trajectory. So for that, what we need to do is mostly to build efficient solvers. Because as I said, it's optimization problem that we need to solve online during the movement of the robot. And the problem that we need to solve, they are difficult to solve. So these solvers, they need a lot of nice mathematical features, but features that are difficult to get. They need to be stable despite the instability of numerical predictions. For that, we do multiple shooting. They need to be sparse because there is a lot of sparsity in the problem that we are writing. And for that, we are doing differential dynamic programming. We are subject to strict constraints. And for that, we are using Lagrangian augmentation. And on that, we are trying with Justin Carpentier to build solvers that are able to take the decision in real time. And that's typically the kind of decision that are taken after 10 milliseconds of computation with the complexity of a robot. So I think I put some numbers here. So what is the complexity? So for a quadruped, for example, with four cycles of trot, that's typically what you want to optimize, you would have 8,000 variables. And you need to get 12 iterations of this solver to get a walk, each iteration costing you 9 milliseconds on a good computer. For a humanoid, you would typically optimize two steps. That would be 12,000 variables, 18 iterations, and you get 30 milliseconds by iteration. These times are very important because typically the control loop of a robot would be 1 millisecond. So already with 30 milliseconds, we are a little bit out of the time that is allocated. We need to interpolate in between two solutions. But here we are. We have a proof of concept that we are able to optimize a sane duration of prediction of the robot in real time. Maybe insisting a little bit that on what is maybe the most important aspect to get this this speed is the sparsity. When we write the Hessian of the Lagrangian of the problem, we will typically get a matrix like that where all the white parts are zeros. So you see there is a lot of zeros, so it's very sparse. But more than sparse, it's also very structured. So you have bands of values, and that's it. The rest are null. So we need to handle sparsity, but we also need to handle structure. And then each of the blocks that are non-zero here, it's again sparse. And this sparsity now is not coming from the temporal aspect of the problem, but it's coming from the spatial aspect of the robot. The robot is tree-based, so it's composed of a basis with a right leg, left leg, a torso, right arm, left arm, and head. And each of that would compose a block in this matrix. This one is less sparse than this one, and the structure is a little bit more complex. We say it's branch-induced. But also, with a good algorithm, we are able to handle that. And in particular, this one is very nicely handled by the software Pinocchio, for which Justin is the guru, which is allowing us to be basically on that topic the best of the world. The typical numbers that we get for big robots are around the megahertz of computation as an order of magnitude. So we are able to get the dynamics of the robot and the derivative of the dynamics something like 1 million times per second. And the typical unit that we are using to benchmark our algorithm is a microsecond. And for me, it's not a unit that I was used to use in the past, and in particular for algorithm. I insist on that because some people think that we need to, for example, learn or approximate this aspect. But these algorithms, they are in fact super, super easy, super efficient. Might seem counterintuitive that computing all the forces applying to a tree structure like that is easy, but actually it is. It is easy for us, and it is easy for our computers. They can do that millions of times per second without any problem. Okay, so don't approximate. We have perfect model for that. Now I'm trying to give a concrete idea of the efficiency that we get. So here I implemented a walking behavior on the robot. So I'm asking the robot to I'm asking the optimizer to get an optimal behavior of this robot, and I put that in IPOPT. So you can see there is here 5,000 variables, and that would be the speed of resolution of the system. Every 10 seconds, you get one iteration of the solver. Of course, if you want to apply that on the robot, we are very, very far from what can be achieved. So instead, I run our own solver, and this is for exactly the same problem, the speed that you can get, and immediately you would get an optimization that is, well, nice, the robot is behaving properly. In the meantime, IPOPT is still optimizing. So state of the art is really not what we need for this kind of robot. We were at 18 as a cost, while the optimal cost is typically 1. So now we can go to do optimal model predictive control. So we would run the solver first time, and then at each line that is appearing, it's a new control cycle of the robot that is now working in real time, while in the meantime, IPOPT is still optimizing. So these aspects are very important. That sounds very technological, and actually it is very technological. We are spending a lot of time, and in particular Justin is spending a lot of time implementing these algorithms. And if we don't do that properly, then basically nothing works at all. But first, it's a basis, it's a baseline. We need to have that so that we then can do the nice mathematics, the nice algorithms that make us progress. And also, it's done. So we don't need to discuss whether it is possible or not. It's something that is already existing. So maybe we just need to support the existing developments, but there is no discussion whether they are useful or not. At least that's my opinion. Okay, so maybe time for another break. So at the end of this this presentation, of this second part, I explained that we have optimal control solvers that are able to get optimal trajectories in real time, and that's costing something like a millisecond of computations. Is anybody willing to interact after that? Well, if I don't try, it would not work. But the reciprocal is not true. Okay, so what do we need on top of that? So what I like very much with optimal control is that there is this long decision in this long discussion in robotics whether it is your algorithm planning or control. Well, optimal control is both, and we can then wonder what is missing on top of that. Well, what is missing is a little bit of guidance. So I would argue that we can say it's planning when it's global, and then maybe for planning we don't care of real time, while we can say it's control when it is real time, and then for control maybe we don't care that it is global. But even for walking, we need a little bit of globalization. So we need the robot to be able to discover that it's able to lift the foot. And that actually is a difficult problem. So here I take the example of the robot starting in a standing position. He has a control, so he has a prediction where he's standing still, but there is a disturbance, he is strongly pushed in the back. And now we need to capture this fall. And for capturing a fall like that, there is two strategies. The first one is to rotate the arms so that you create angular momentum. And this angular momentum, you will counterbalance it with forces on the ground. Now these forces can also help you to bring your center of mass back to rest position. And that's very easy to find. So if you ask a solver to search for push recovery, very, very quickly, it will generate angular momentum with the arms so that a part of the fall is recovered. But this strategy is not super useful because your arms are quite light, even for a robot. So the quantity of angular momentum that you can generate is limited. The second strategy is to lift one of the foot and push it forward so that you can capture by applying a force forward. But this means that at some point you need to unbalance yourself even more. So that's not good for an optimal control solver or for an optimization solver to kind of degrade your current candidate solution while you are seeking for something else. And maybe even this solution is behind a hill, so you need to accept that your cost is raising a little bit. But once you discover that using your foot is a viable strategy, then optimizing the foot and discovering walk is super easy. So what I said is that we are losing a lot of time to invent walk. And the problem in trajectory optimization is that each time the robot would have to make a step, it would reinvent walk. So in the state of the art, we are typically using warm start. So that's where we are using smart models so that this part of the search, which is very costly, disappears. Now we are trying to use offline learning to produce this model, to invent this model so that we don't have to do that manually. So what we did in a European project that just finished called Memory of Motion, that we combine these efficient online whole body predictive control solvers with offline exploration, so producing tons of examples of sign robot behavior offline and encoding these behaviors by supervision into any oracle. So here is, for example, one of the data sets that we produce with our motion planners offline, and that then we learn to guide the solver online. And this is an example, well, that's a simpler example where this learning is needed. So there is an obstacle in front of the robot, and we are asking the robot to follow a target that is shown in front of him. Going around the obstacle is something that is not in the current local minimum, so the solver is not able to find it, except if we have good globalization. And then when the robot is blocked against the obstacles, he would trigger the memory to produce a new candidate solution from which he would optimize to go around the obstacle. And this idea has been demonstrated on three case studies. So in Toulouse, we were working with this humanoid robot with the interest of Airbus that is seeking for this universal worker robot. And we have demonstrated some activities. We are still a little bit far from a realistic technology readiness. But still, we are able to do some tooling tasks, some walking on flat terrain, climbing a stair, or polishing an object. Demonstration inside Airbus were not public, and we were not able to release that. We have demonstrated that for an exoskeleton walking with paraplegic patients. So here, the old man inside the exoskeleton is paraplegic. He has no control at all over his leg, and the exoskeleton is stabilizing his walk. There is a med behind for securing the behavior of the robot, but the med is not useful for the balance. And finally, we demonstrated that for a quadruped robot walking in a civil engineering scenario, either climbing a stiff stair or going around obstacles on site. And yeah. We are very happy with this result. So here, at least in terms of optimizing and training, a first partial answer would be, well, we can do both at the same time. We can use learning, supervised learning, to produce a warm start, and then optimizing for refining this warm start and making it optimal. And reciprocally, we can use optimization to produce data set that would be encoded into a learned structure. We are trying to push a little bit further by making these two problems a single one and trying to solve the two problems together. For that, what we did is offline on a cluster, we samples a given numbers of state of the robot, and we try to connect all these states together. So say, for example, we take 30 states, and we want to connect all of them. So at the end, we are seeking for something like 1,000 trajectories. And we are using our optimal control solver to produce these trajectories. Our optimal control solver is local. So it would only produce some of the requested trajectories, so by experience, something like 20%. And among these 20%, not all of them are globally optimum. Some of them are only locally optimum. And say, again, 20% are maybe globally optimum. The rest is locally optimum. And then we cut these trajectories into sub-pieces so that we have a huge data set, and we can start to treat that as a mass of data that we push into a neural network. The neural network is learning the policy function, but also the optimal trajectories and what we call the value function. Well, let's not insist on that. And then we are going to iterate that. Once we have this neural network storing our approximation, it can be triggered to a given idea of what is the solution that we search, and we would optimize it again, producing a better data set, training a better neural network, producing a better data set, and this would get reinforced. So we see that as a way of turning the reinforcement learning problem into an optimization problem, a trajectory optimization problem, which is a static optimization problem, and a supervised learning problem, which is also a static optimization problem. And that can be discussed. Is it really reinforcement learning? Well, I think on the definition of it, yes, it is, in the sense that we are at the same time generating the data and learning the data. So we don't have a data set that is given in the beginning, but it's not at least the same algorithm, or not at all the same principle of the algorithm that are running on many robots, and in particular on many quadruped robots, like for example on our robot, where we are fully training with PPO, with a classical reinforcement learning algorithm, control policy. And that actually it's also working very well in something like a few hours of computation on a big GPU. You get something that is immediately transferable to a real robot like this one. And this real robot is able to walk now on flat terrain, but it's also able to get a little bit of robustness. For example, if there is some slope like what is coming. And so here there is really a question of is it enough? So let's discuss that a little bit. So first, from this reinforcement learning success, but also from what we did with the memory of motion, I think we have evidence that a robot policy can be stored in a neural network. There is no issue with that. There is way enough space in a neural network to store all the data that we need for robot motion. Also, accuracy is still questionable. So maybe not by the fact of the network itself, but by the fact of the algorithm that tends to have difficulty to converge to an accurate minimum. So what is optimization good then with respect to that? Well, first, optimizers are much better to quickly discover relevant movements. And it's already used for producing basic data for the reinforcement learning training. For now, there is no big question about how to transfer from an optimal trajectory to a neural network. And clearly, there is way more than just cloning. Just not giving the control and say, well, please copy this control. That's not at all what we know from the optimal trajectories. We know derivatives. We know the value function. So we know way more than just cloning. So there is ideas and mathematics to be developed in the sense of how we couple the training of the training part of a reinforcement learning problem with trait optimization. Second aspect is at runtime on the robot, I still argue that we need hard constraints to be satisfied. And for now, there is no strong ideas about how to enforce hard constraints with a neural network. So I still argue that we need optimization at runtime, both for enforcing constraints, so like for post-processing the output of a neural network, but also for generalization, because we cannot guarantee that all the possible situation has been seen at training time. So at the end, should we learn or optimize the motion of a leg robot? Optimization is needed. We need generalization. And in that sense, we can say MPC is a one-shot learning. We need to enforce constraints. And that's the only roadmap that I see to get AI with guarantees. And also something that we fail until now to really quantify is I really believe that we need accuracy. Numerical accuracy is super important for robots, especially for big robots, very unstable like humanoid ones. We also need motion learning. I really don't see other way of getting globalization, except that from learning at real time, at runtime, we need globalization, and we don't have time for reinventing the wheel when a new obstacle arrives. Better reinforcement learning algorithms are needed. That also, I'm convinced of that. We don't have enough guarantee and not enough efficiency for the algorithm that we currently have. And also a last message is there is a lot of intelligence in the hardware, and artificial intelligence is not enough about hardware design. So there is a lot of room for that as well. This junction between learning and optimization is my vision of hybrid AI, and hybrid AI is the main motif of Aniti, the 3IA from Toulouse. So that's my contribution to hybrid AI. A lot of this work has been done thanks to Thomas Flayol and Olivier Stas, and of course all this work is from the GPTO team at large. Thank you for your attention, and maybe now we can have a discussion.
Okay, thank you Nicolas for this very complete talk on locomotion for legged robots. So maybe we have a question from the audience. There was a question from Alexandre, so I don't know if you can ask it.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. Hi, Mr. Mansart. So I had a question about the computation time. So at some point, you said that one iteration of the motion planning would take 10 to 10 milliseconds, and you would have to perform 10 to 12 steps. This yields 100 milliseconds for complete optimization. And then you said that you can optimize in real time, so in a 1 millisecond control loop. Could you explain? Because I must have not understood that.
Yeah. So at runtime, we are only allowing one iteration of the solver. We could do several iterations, but very likely on many practical situations, we would have a new sensor measurement in the meantime. And then the question is whether we should do the next iteration on the past measurement or on the current measurement. So the principle of model predictive control is to do the next step of optimization on the new sensor measurement. So you would optimize with disturbance if you want. And now this would work if your innovation capability of your solver is faster than the changes in your environment. When we optimize at the next control cycle, we won't start with the previous solution. This previous solution, we shift it of one time step. Okay. So actually, what we need on the robot is 10 milliseconds of computation because only one control cycle, one iteration of the server. Now, actually, as I said, it's 1 millisecond and not 10 milliseconds that is allowed on the robot. And for that, what we are doing is we are doing a first order Taylor expansion of the optimal solution. So we are taking the derivative of the solver and we do a linear interpolation of the solution every millisecond. This is strongly connected with what is called the Riccati gains. So typical feedback gains that are arising from the LQR below the optimization problem. So it's stuff that are well known in control theory. But you can understand that as a just Taylor expansion.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Nicolas. So do you have some other questions from people remotely connected?
Hi, it's Carola. I have a question about the reinforcement learning that you're using. Is that, would you say that you said that we need better reinforcement learning? Do you think that this better means you need to adjust it to your specific type of application, or like what kind of reinforcement learning approaches do you use? You mentioned PPO.
Yeah, good question. So yes, in robotics, I think we have a particular problem, and this particular problem is wide enough so that we tailor a little bit the algorithms. So in particular, in robotics, we have very, very good knowledge of our model. So we don't say at all that we have a black box. And also, we cannot afford the number of iterations that would be needed for training, for reinforcement learning training on the real robot. So we absolutely need a simulator. And I think it's good. I like very much simulators. Simulators is very, very good for generalization. But we know way more on simulators than just a rollout. We know the derivatives, we know constraints. So we are able to do that in robotics and maybe not in other fields where reinforcement learning is meaningful. So for robotics, I would argue that we need reinforcement learning algorithms that are able to better take advantage of the simulators. And I really think it's not cheating at all, because we have this knowledge. So it's a waste not to use it.
Okay. Yeah, I totally agree. I think there's a lot of potential in adjusting reinforcement learning and making it more specific for specific type of applications. Totally
agree. I'm really seeking for a reinforcement learning algorithm that would use the derivative of the environment, both the simulation and the reward.
Yeah, thank you.
Hello, Nicolas. Julien Perassia from Navarre Labs. Hello, Nicolas. So I just wanted to react on the point you were mentioning here about this hypothesis that we have actually knowledge of the of the transition function, basically the environment. But I have the feeling that when you claim this knowledge, it's more about the knowledge of the robot itself than its environment. And you know that in reinforcement learning, one of the biggest hypotheses is that we do not assume the knowledge of the overall environment, which is basically the proprioception and the exteroception, the environment itself. So for example, we know in quadruped, one of the big issues is actually the friction under the feet and how we should be robust to that. For example, if you walk on ice and these kind of things. And from what I understand, you have it seems that you have a strong belief that that's the kind of knowledge that we have also. So I would be very interesting to know, how do you see that this kind of knowledge, again, not of the robot itself, but the environment, how do you see that we could have this kind of knowledge, not only in simulation, but in the real execution of our robot?
So first of all, there is many different level of behavior that you expect from a robot. And for some of them, we may seek for different parts of the algorithm. So here I'm very interested by motion, by real control of the real robot. And for that, I would argue that for now, accuracy is more important than knowledge. We need to have more accuracy in the way we are controlling robots. And if for that we need to inject a little bit more knowledge, it's fine. The second point is that yes, we have a lot of knowledge, and maybe we don't have exact numbers, but we know what is friction. Getting the exact value of the friction coefficient in advance for when you are going to walk on a new floor, that's a number that you don't have, but you exactly know what is friction. You are able to very well model it, and now you can start to say, well, I'm robust to wrong numbers in the parameters of this behavior, of this phenomena. And I really think we need to have that, right? I'm not at all saying that I believe my model of the world is perfect. I'm just saying I have a model of the world, but you too, right? We exactly have the same model of the world, whether we are doing model predictive control or reinforcement learning. I'm using exactly the same simulator as you are. I'm just saying that for the simulators that you have, you absolutely need to take more advantage of it because you're wasting resources. I'm not saying that I have better model than you.
Totally understood. Thank you. Thank you very much. Totally understood. Thank you so much, Nicola.
Tommy Selander, again from the neighbor labs. How about not using the simulator at all, but learning in the robot itself?
Yeah, it's a nice objective. I'm pragmatic. For now, what we have are algorithms that are needing a million of runs, and that's not scaling at all. Maybe in the future, we would have algorithms that can go in a 10 iteration, and I would be super happy with that. But there is a very small, maybe not. When they would come, I would be very, very happy to switch. For now, as a roboticist, I would not seek for that. I think there is plenty of room for mathematicians to go for reinforcement learning algorithms that are able to converge in 10 iterations. But one way of getting that way faster is to use derivatives. And I don't think that going on the robot, pretending we don't know anything about physics is very sane. I don't see the point. I mean, metaphysically, yes, I understand, but we have the model of the robot, so I would prefer to focus really on hard problems that are I don't find that super meaningful. And I understand the principle, but for now, I would say go with the asset that we have. One of the assets is the model.
Don't you think it restricts the kind of robots we build? We build robots that can be modeled.
Yes, maybe that's possible. So our robots are very stiff because we want to model them as rigid. And then because they are very stiff, they are also very heavy, and that's suboptimal. And I agree with that. We need to have something, I don't think it's we have flexible robots like the robots that are developed in Lille. They are very smart and very difficult to model. But even for these robots, a mainstream of research on that is modeling them, and they have very good models. So our intelligence is able to build very, very nice models. And then we have them and we can spare a lot of computation. I like models.
Hello, can I ask a question? Yeah, so I was wondering, it's a bit related to what Julien asked, but I was thinking if you could also update the simulator in real time as the robot is doing something. So like discover new properties about the environment or something and include them in real time. Do you think this would be an interesting thing to do?
Yeah, sure. We need to do that for real applications. So that adaptive control, we have a model and we perceive that the behavior of the robot is not similar to the model. And then we optimize the model so that it behaves like what we have measured. Your supervisor is doing that all the time. I'm not, because I have very good model robot for which we have very good robots, but I'm convinced that we would need to do that for practical robots, sure. Adaptive control.
For example, you were saying that you could design control that is robust to errors in like the friction coefficient. But do you think maybe it would be like, instead of just designing robustness, maybe just like try to do some exploratory motions to try to find out the exact friction coefficient or something like this?
Yeah, I think you need to do both. So something we are not doing in a predictive control is domain randomization. Because we are lacking a little bit of time, or because we are not using GPU at runtime, or because just nobody really looked at it, it was not in the top priority. But we typically could. So instead of predicting one model, the behavior of one model, we would predict the behavior of 10 models. It's not much more expensive. And then, for example, for the friction coefficient, you are going to put your foot on a stair on top of on a step on top of a stair, and you are going to model to predict that with a various coefficient of friction because you don't know what to expect. And it's much better, right? Because if you start to slide on the step, the result is going to be catastrophic. And at the same time, now you put your foot on the first step, you see that the behavior that you have is not similar to what you predicted, and you can correct. I think you need to know.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
And we have the mathematics and the algorithmics to do both, right? That's we lack a little bit practical aspect, but there is a road for doing that. It's not something that is not known.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so do we have other questions from the audience? So I think we had several of them. So thank you very much, Nicolas, for your nice talk and nice answers for the question and all the questions raised by people. So I guess that we will meet soon between Aniti and Prairie for a colloquium in June, end of June, I think, if I remember well, where we can just discuss more on these topics. So thank you again, Nicolas, for talking today, and hopefully we will also meet for Prairie colloquium next month. I don't remember the exact day, but see you at this time.
Okay, thank you for having me, and have a good day.
Yeah, thank you, Nicolas. Bye. Bon, j'essaie de suspendre l'enregistrement, mais ça marche pas très bien.